against the healthcare bill that was passed by the Republicans that would devastate so many people. It was passed without any CBO projections and things like that. You know, and it shows that pick any number of things that they call it a healthcare bill, but in reality it was a tax bill as well as a healthcare bill, because that act, if it's actually enacted into law, would repeal the capital gains on the sale of stocks and bonds, you know, that affect people. I mean, affect people that have more than $250,000, but that loss of revenue from repealing that part of the tax amounts to $600 billion. And that $600 billion needed to be offset by something. And the way it was offset was to decrease the funding for the child's health insurance program and Medicaid expansion. And that will result in so many things that will affect individuals drastically. Two-thirds of our seniors that are in nursing homes are on Medicaid. You know, and so what's going to happen when that revenue disappears? Where are grandmothers going to go? I mean, you know, where are our parents going to go? I mean, yes, there might be occasions where they can live with their families, but that's not the case. It will put stress on the families. In any event, that's just one example. After school activities is another example. You know, these things are misguided and lack of compassion. And so, these are very difficult things, but I'm very, very hopeful that we can change things. We need to elect a Democrat to Congress. I know that the country is, I can tell you that there was a poll that was done, came out just before Labor Day. It's very, very encouraging. If you look at what the result was in November 2016, the difference between Mulvaney and the Democratic and his Democratic opponent, and you look at where the poll was last Friday before Memorial Day, you cut that lead in more than half.
Saying anything about that, I'm not that.
do think that we do need strict gun control.
Other questions?
Yes, ma'am. What particular skills do you bring, that you can bring to Congress to work with the other side?
Right, okay. Thank you, question. Very good question. By way of context, there were four debates that both Democrats and Republicans sat together on the same stage before the primary. Held on May 2nd. So it was kind of a crowded stage. There were seven Republicans, three Democrats, and at the very first one of those, which was in Newberry, I said that it's a very good thing that we're sitting. I'd like to introduce Martin O'Malley.
Everything's going to be okay. So thank you both for what you're doing. I'm going to come back to Archie in a second. Vincent, thank you for your introduction and for being my friend, man. And thank you for reminding me why it is I like you. And that's because your mother's from Baltimore. Good to see you. Good to see you. Thank you.
Baltimore.
Only two syllables. But look, it's a great honor to be here with all of you, and I don't say that lightly. I love your state, and I love the affinity that your state and my state share. And as I came across the hallowed revolutionary grounds here, up to this gathering, where all of you are focused on the country's future, I could not help but notice one of those Kaufman's flags, you know, with the 12 stars and the one in the center. Well, that was a symbol that was brought here by the Maryland 400. And they were part of Washington's, they called them, there's a book out recently called Washington's Immortals. And this was 400 sons of Maryland who went right into the breach of some of the toughest times.
They were here.
They were here as well. And they were at the Battle of Long Island.
Battle of Camden, Hospital, a lot of them brought right here.
How about that? Well, they fought under a flag that had 13 stars and 13 stripes, I'm fond of remembering. But with my state, the middle state, Maryland, the stars were arranged in a circle. And there was one star in the center. That middle state, that central state, around which other states rallied in times of great adversity. Well, that star shifted a bit now. And that star is now here in the 5th Congressional District of South Carolina. And the people of our country, the people of our country have been appalled at the mean spiritedness that we have seen take over our White House after 8 years of the courageous and elegant and gracious leadership of Barack Obama. And people want to do something about it, right? How many of your neighbors you talk to, I know that many of you are active Democrats. You fought with Vincent courageously by his side in his gubernatorial campaigns. You guys must run into people all the time and say, what can I do about it? What can I do about it? Together, what can we do about it? Well, with this open congressional seat, you can actually do something about it. The neighbors you talk to, the people you talk to, don't give up on them. Some of them probably actually voted for Donald Trump. That's okay. Don't give up on them, because if they're not disappointed yet, they soon will be. They soon will be. And that's why congressional seats are up every 2 years, right? Great. The founders were pretty bright people in many respects. They knew that great republics won't be infallible. Sometimes we'll make mistakes, and that's why we're able to correct them in the very next midterms, or in this case, in the special election. Many of you I know rallied around Vincent and his campaigns because of the courage he showed in the State House, the courage to have people face the future, passing the bill that made sure that South Carolina had the right to their fair share of federal dollars in the Recovery and Reinvestment Act, when the ideologues wanted to turn those dollars away, when people were suffering. We don't need more ideologues. We need people that do common sense and courageous things. The Land Conservation Trust that Vincent was instrumental in creating. Why do you do that? Why are you proud of that? It was because it was something that he wasn't doing for himself or even for us in the here and now. This is something we do for the future. And that's what we need to return to again as a country. And our representatives should actually represent us. We're not ideologues. We're not about left and right. We're about forward or back. And that's what Archie Parnell is going to be about. This is a man who has a background that is an all-American background. I mean, he worked his way through college, working three different jobs to get through college. His father was a master sergeant, as he probably told you, in the United States Air Force. My dad was in the Army Air Corps, which I guess means he predated your dad by a couple of years. One of the things that his father did afterwards was actually a letter carrier, actually delivering those Social Security checks that he wants to go to Washington to defend against the ideologues that would like to privatize it. You need a representative who's actually going to represent your district, who's actually going to stand up for the goodness that's within our country and within each and every part of the 5th Congressional District. Congressman Spratt was that kind of a leader that brought people together. Remember back in our Congress not too long ago? Yeah. There were actually people that thought it was their job to bring people together instead of drive them apart. That's the sort of person that Archie will be. His very first job out of school was to work for our Justice Department. But he's also somebody that's had experience in corporate America. You know, he understands better than most, probably, the tax loopholes that can and must be closed so corporations and banks actually pay their fair share, work by the rules, and make our country a better place. Look, at the end of the day, the reason we even have a country is so we can take actions together that strengthen and build up our middle class, right? And our parents and grandparents understood that the stronger we make our country, the more she gives back to us. The Chinese have a nation of their own to invest in. Nobody's going to rebuild our roads and infrastructure but us. Archie understands that, and he'll fight to make sure those dollars and those investments are made here. It's not so much a matter of us coming up with a new formula. Yeah, the challenges are different. Automation and global trade and all of that stuff. The challenges are always a little different. But the fundamentals remain the same, don't they? I mean, we've got to build an economy where we understand that our economy is not money, it's people. It's all of our people. When they work hard, people should be able to get ahead. Let me say a word or two by way of distinction about Archie's and Hope. You want to talk about ideologues? How about this? Bumping along your South Carolina roads. Yeah, this guy's voted against every single road bill that ever came to the legislature, with the exception of the road that went into his corporate property. Let me give you another one. This is a person who, as an ideologue, railed against taking any money from the federal government to help people get out of the recession. And yet, on the bank in which he sat as a board member, he sure as heck took the TARP dollars to bail out that bank, didn't he? Third, this is a guy who fans all the xenophobic flames about how we have to protect ourselves from those other people that want to steal our jobs and those immigrants that we need to build a wall against. And yet, he hired undocumented people to work on his own properties. Look, I know a lot of people do that, but please spare me the hypocrisy of treating people like they're self-interested.